This is a record of lecture 9, Geology 2017. In this lecture, we are going to introduce a couple of other tectonic settings and related magmatism. So we are going back to some of the concepts revolving around volcanoes, but we will focus on volcanoes that are found mostly on subduction-dominated settings. So, if you remember, in the last lecture we were talking about mostly extensional tectonics, so we worked on mid-oceanic ridges quite a bit, looking at ophiolites. Now we shift to the last couple of tectonic settings, which will be island arcs, as well as subduction zones that are actually arcs that involve continental crust. So we have oceanic crust subducting under continental crust. So these two scenarios are really the key objective today, but firstly we will get sort of an overview of some of the key criteria that are sort of try to explain the type of subduction, the morphology of the subduction, and also the composition of magmas associated with these subduction related domains. So in this context, the activity often is focused on arcuate volcanic islands, which are commonly chains of islands that form a long subduction zone. So it's very similar in a way to what we find in mid-oceanic ridges, but so we have essentially chains of volcanoes also in this context. However, the morphology is different, because instead of having straight volcanoes that are essentially aligned along major rift systems, we tend to have arcs that form in most of the oceanic examples. So oceanic-oceanic subduction will be really dominated by these cases. This situation changes a little bit when we are dealing with continental subduction, because of the rigidity of the silic crust, but still these arcs are also present in some of these tectonic settings that involve continental crust. Composition is more diverse and silicic than the morbs, and this is obvious. We have quite a bit of involvement of subducting plates, so a lot of hydration and devolatilization occurring in amphibole, and you can expect these minerals to liberate also through melting, a combination of factors, and you also get contamination while you are going through more older crust, which would have usually a higher alkalinity, which explains some of the trend we find, so the calc-alkaline trends mainly. We will see also that the magmas usually are more oxidized, another important aspect really with respect to the additional enrichment in incompatible elements. Also these usually have little basalt. We tend to have much more andesitic magmas, more differentiated phases as a result of the interaction with crust, especially in the continental settings. Also, these are more explosive, and of course this is linked to the silica content of the magmas, so we return to some of the conversations we were having about fractionation and the image of the Yellowstone caldera should come up to your mind when you are thinking about this dualism in terms of magmatism. So a lot of the fractionation that we see in those continental settings for rising magmas that establish their magmatic chambers at relatively shallow levels will be also one of the aspects that is key for the stratovolcanoes. So explosive activity is this result of interaction with surficial fluids as well as more silicic magmas. If you look at the distribution of subduction zones in the planet, they are focused all around the Pacific. We can discuss some of the main example of oceanic crust subduction. So the first would be the Kermadec Tonga Trench, which is essentially located east of New Zealand, northeast, and also we have the Marianas and Japan trenches, Papua trenches, Aleutian trenches. All these form, together with the Sunda and Banda Aceh trench, part of the Pacific Ring of Fire. On the side of the Americas, we have more continental related subduction with the Nazca Plate going underneath South America. And then I have examples here of the Central American and Cascade ranges. So the Yellowstone examples are up there in the North America side of things, so close to Vancouver and Seattle. And then we end up with some of the volcanoes we were talking about, the Vesuvius, the Aeolian Islands, all those, if you remember, I mentioned they were linked to this subduction that is occurring between the African plate and the Eurasian plate. And you have here a sort of a bigger scale representation of this subduction, which is very extensive. It essentially connects roughly with the Himalayan example here, with this massive plateau forming, and also Turkey here, which is known for its seismic activity, and yes, a lot of the gold deposits, for example, are found in Turkey, are linked really to these seismogenic events. And then we go back to Italy with the volcanism, which is quite prominent, and move off the coast of Spain, which is also well known from history for its extensive resources of lead zinc deposits along the Pyritic belt. So this should give you sort of an overview really of the different areas where we find subduction. I would say some of the most active domains are really here along the Pacific margins. So Pacific Plate is, as you know, quite extensively affected by continuous subduction, and it's the one that it has the highest velocities in terms of consumption of crust. This is probably linked to the fact that these are all oceanic subductions, so in a way these are easier to develop, I think, in relationship to the fact that usually to subduct a continent, it's much more complex, and you get continent-continent collisions in many instances, which are even more complex and increase the challenge in sort of taking crust underneath into the mantle, which is leading to a slowing with respect to the process of subduction, which will be this example in this domain. If we move on, we can identify, and whenever we have a subduction, usually we encounter a variation in the heat flow. So quite often, volcanism will be accompanied with again, anomalous geothermal gradients. At the same time, in combination with the anomalous geothermal gradient, quite often we have thickening of the crust in a process of arc production. So usually this is structural, so we have stacks of thrusts that tend to essentially accumulate different overlays of or slivers of crust. And quite often underneath this thickened crust, which could be termed the accretionary prism, and it's found in the forearc region. Again, the forearc will be between the volcanic arc and the subducting crust. Underneath, we'll find the mantle wedge. So within essentially an area that is roughly 110 kilometers in thickness, we get the majority of the magmatism taking place with crustal melting and usually formation of multiple magmatic chambers. Some of the activity will also occur in the back arc basins, and quite often we have an area which is termed the Benioff Wadati zone, which is famous for the localization of the hypocenter of earthquakes. So these are highly seismic domains. You have examples from Japan, one of the most active countries in terms of earthquakes. They have continuous earthquakes forming in response to the movements along the Benioff Wadati zone. Seismic has been extensively used to actually map this surface of discontinuity, so we have good knowledge of how the crust proceeds when it goes underneath the mantle and forms this critical boundary. One of the key aspects I was mentioning is the fact that subduction is commonly occurring with the formation of an arc. So a question that we could ask is, why arcs rather than straight islands like we see in the hotspots example? Is this, for example, linked to the rotation of the crust, or is this something else? So what kind of processes are controlling the curvature? It turns out that the arcs are essentially curved in response to the fact that it's difficult and challenging to cause the subduction of curved crust, because the Earth's surface is effectively curved. You can see an image here of a cupola, which would represent a section of planet Earth, and we can see a situation in which we have progressively some crust that is going under a subduction zone. So in a way, it has been demonstrated that when the slab starts to go under subduction, it will form a tear in the center, and there is essentially an instability location that tends to form at this central location, which forms essentially a kink, and this justifies why you get this embayment, and subduction zones tend to be curved in the majority of the ocean example. You can see here the curvature, another one here in Papua, and these the ones from Japan as well. So this is quite evident also if you look at the Aleutian. So these are also very much showing and displaying a significant amount of curvature, even if you are going underneath the continental crust, which would be the Alaska, or essentially the northern part of North America. Similar is true also for South America. Some portions are relatively straight, but this domain is displaying a similar type of curvature. And so quite often this is good to understand the direction of subduction. If you recognize an arc that has is cuspated, usually the concavity is indicating the direction of subduction, which would be this arrow in here. And this is at the border between Patagonia and the Antarctica. And here is an image that shows what I was mentioning. So you have here the scotia plate and yes, the scotia plate that is basically partly in subduction, and this is also called the chain of islands. You can see here in red, because this is an elevation map. So red are higher spots. This would be called the sandwich islands. So that's why you get this double S here. Other examples here of variable orientation of subduction related trenches in the Western Pacific in this case, and yes, it's worth noting the strike variation with respect to the overall Pacific plate motion, which are the white arrows. So everything is moving pretty much in the same direction, but the position of these trenches vary and essentially wraps around the margin of the Pacific plate, which is sort of course a function conditioning essentially the velocity of subduction. So it's expected that this part would be slower if compared to these other, which are more orthogonal to the direction of movement of the main plate. Sometimes we use particular geophysical methods to investigate the morphology of the crust at depth, and I'm talking about crust that is going under subduction, and often this is a discipline called crustal tomography because of that. So you have here a couple of examples of papers that present tomographic images. These are of course based on the pressure wave velocities, so you can see differences expressed as a percentage, and often the velocity will tend to be higher in the cold crust. So these are essentially domains of cold crust that is subducting, and we are able to recover velocities of earthquakes, and here you have different populations of earthquakes, really illustrating the fact that earthquakes tend to be focused on the upper part of the subducting plate basically. So this is well evident. We have different profiles, but yes, the information is very similar across most of them. And you can also see the position of the arc in the different locations as well. In these other images, we see a more complex example in which in New Zealand we see essentially a separation of the slab. So it's going in subduction situation, but likely the situation is more complex because it seems we have essentially a cold region also underneath part of New Zealand, which would indicate that there has been a rotation of this fragment of crust that will be subdivided in chunks, because you have apparently also a small fragment underneath. You can see it here a little bit better. Again, these are P-wave velocity perturbations that will be a function of the changes in density that occurs. So it's a concept that is very similar to what we saw for the hot spot in Iceland, just a different way of plotting this. Rather than in three dimensions, we are looking at series of cross sections through this subduction domain. This is an example of ocean Japan type subduction. Important is to realize that we have this window where often we tend to have major amount of dehydration and deformation of magmas that then rise and form magma ponding at different levels between mantle and crust, very frequently, if you remember, I was mentioning that with the plumes. And here is the process is similar. You will start to form quite a bit of fractionation at this interface. We tend to form quite a bit of gabbros here, and then we move up and form the andesitic porphyries in relationship to these active volcanic arcs. Interestingly, in this diagram, we see also a variation in the abundance of specific minerals. So we start with oceanic crust that is relatively hydrated and composed of mafic rocks plus sediment, and the subduction proceeds with a first phase in which we usually strip off the water off the amphibole, and we have a situation in which we tend to form serpentinite. So we start to serpentinize this chunk of crust. While we move down, we have usually a change, and we start to have the dehydration of amphibole producing eclogitic rocks, so more pyroxene-rich rocks and garnet-rich rocks, which have less amphibole, I would say. And so this is, okay, function of pressure and temperature. Remember, at higher pressure and temperature, we enter the eclogite field and we will develop metamorphic rocks as part of this process. We haven't discussed a lot about metamorphism, but it is quite clear the fact that the mineralogy is conditioned by pressure and temperature, as well as the availability of fluid will be playing a critical role. In fact, in most cases, this process leads to the liberation of fluids that are removed from the amphibole, and so the phase separation tends to form more dehydrated melts and materials. So eclogitic rocks will have less water and other volatiles if compared to serpentinites and other sort of more basaltic components, which are more enriched in amphibole. Tearing of slab with stagnant behavior is some of the things that are facilitating the rise of fluid. This is the example of the Japan and Itsuboning slabs. So we are in the Pacific. Quite often we have situations in which multiple arcs were originally a single arc, but through deformation we essentially create a central rupture and tearing, and of course in this case you create a gap where the mantle can rise and you have more pronounced magmatism that and fluid circulation that might be linked to these processes of slab tearing. So if we try to explain why this slab tearing occurs, we should appeal to two factors. One is the factor that essentially the slab is bent, and the other is the direction of subduction. So we have essentially two forces that are pulling in response to these two factors, and as a result we form the central tearing. Here are some tomographic images again with a percent difference in P velocity. So in this particular case in purple we have the distribution of earthquakes, and you can see the bending I was mentioning and also some of the tearing starts to become more evident. Of course, this is a shallower section, so these are horizontal slices through the crust and mantle, and so it's interesting to see that progressively while we move down we start to see a break or a necking forming in the central part, and also this is shown by the heterogeneous distribution of some of the earthquakes, like in this case we have two clusters well defined at depth and a major separation, and also we see this trend that extends the subducting plate much more further east, I would say actually west, and yeah, that's quite evident and suggests that this process is essentially causing a shallowing effect on the more distal part of the subducting plate. So here is a sketch showing that with the example of the Kamchatka Trench. So we are in the Aleutinian examples in this case, and the subduction is essentially part of the Pacific plate, so that's direction of movement I think would be this way, and most of the subduction is rather going this way, and some of the slab tearing forms and we have this separation in the distribution of volcanoes in response to that. Another image of the same area that illustrates the position of the Augustine Island stratovolcano in Alaska. So we're going to have a look at one of these volcanoes, but there are many. You can see here a lot of volcanism occurring along a very extensive arc. It's probably one of the, if not the longest arc on the planet, and strides from Alaska up to a part of the Kamchatka, as I was stating earlier, which would be connecting also with Japan. So the Augustine is relative active volcano. Some of the most recent eruptions date 2006, so we had an earlier sort of micro earthquake in 2005, and then a sequence of events involving pyroclastic activity. So you can see in the background a couple of images, one showing the classic formation of a major pyroclastic event with ash deposits forming, as well as a major lava dome in this area. So similarly to the Mont Saint Helens, we have a highly silicic dome forming in the center, which contributes with the building up of pressure and the formation of massive pyroclastic explosions. And this would coincide with this January 17 explosive eruption, which sent ashes up to 30 kilometers into the atmosphere. So we are talking about Vulcanian eruptions, so almost Plinian eruptions in this case. Remember the 20 kilometer limit as well as the 35 for things that become then really Plinian. In this image, we see also some of the pyroclastic surges that were leading to the formation of major pyroclastic flows along the flank of the volcano, and these occurred on the east side of the Mount Augustine. It's still an event that occurred in 2006. It's interesting to see how these are really represented by massive amount of steam. So we can see quite a bit of steam that is coming off a major flow that interested this area, and it's probably linked to degassing, extensive degassing of the pyroclastic deposits that accumulated at the base of this flank. This map shows the new deposits from the current Augustine eruption, which is the one of the mid-April 2006, and it's been constructing using a variety of things, but mostly aerial observation, photos, and satellite images, and field work. Of course, these are all sort of works in progress. Every time these volcanoes change their morphology very rapidly, but yeah, it's interesting to see the different products here. So we have lavas really close because of the high silicic content of the lavas, they don't travel that far. So in the opposite, if you compare this with Pahoehoe lavas. And then you have, blocks and ash flow deposits, which of course are lighter, and they are pyroclastic deposits, so they get extended more extensively through basal surges and other aspects, such as pyroclastic folds, basically. So all sort of other deposits, of course, the lahar will be even more extensive because they involve mud flows, which can be very destructive and travel much more in extent. So you have some examples of the length of this massive flow, and almost all of them get very close to this the margin of the island along the coast, basically. Here is any a representation of one of those massive pyroclastic flows, and it's also comparing the effect of temperature. So you have a thermal infrared and other air photos here for comparison that show the cooling of the pyroclastic flow deposits on the north flank of Augustine Volcano. This location map shows also the position of the helicopter that actually took this particular photograph, which is part of US Geological Survey and data collection practices when they monitor these type of eruptions. In terms of products, we have mentioned, you know, the production of massive amount of tufs, as well as volcanic breccias and other sort of pyroclastic accumulations. These are some examples of lithic-rich pyroclastic flow deposits, which are more recent and sit on pre-existing tufaceous material, in this case partly unconsolidated, that is dating the pre-2006, so occurred earlier than this last eruption. Of course, these are really extensive accumulations, and you can see some of the major blocks as well in this other figure. In terms of compositions, we can find basalts in these highly silicic volcanics in island arcs, but usually it cannot form from partial melting of basaltic crust. Partial melting of the mantle above the subduction zone is invoked many times to justify this accumulation of basalts, which are minor in terms of volumes, as I was stating at the beginning of the lecture. So we have usually a complex tectonic situation, and because of that we get a spectrum of magmatism very similar to what we saw for the bimodal magmatism observed in intracontinental settings. But here we are on an arc, so there is a tendency of having from basaltic, so oceanic arcs will have basaltic to andesitic compositions in most cases, with a limited exception that are more rhyolitic and ascitic in compositions. So high proportion of basaltic andesite and andesite are certainly a key aspect of these volcanoes. Most andesites are of course the result of more mature subduction settings. So you have here an illustration for different localities. So we got the Japan here, and also the Antilles and the Aleutians, which were examples we were discussing with Mount Augustine. And so you can see these are the most basalt rich, so basaltic andesite actually. And then we have cases that are more dominated by basalts and have combinations of basalt andesites and andesites, and even in some cases quite more silicic magmas that are more dacitic in composition. So you have a legend here for reference after GEOL. So that means that this subduction-related magmatism has quite characteristic magmas that in most cases will be calc-alkaline. So these are compositions that are restricted and quite unique to subduction zones. So if we find a calc-alkaline series that goes from basalts, you know, up to rhyolites and dacites, but become, you know, more, for example, basanitic, more tephritic, more andesitic, in those cases we are really more distinctive for arc environments. Of course, when we talk about calc-alkaline magmas, we tend to appeal to situations where we have significant amount of incompatible elements such as potassium as well as sodium. All those incompatible elements will be more characteristic, and they will be alkalic metals dominantly. so major elements. Another important property I was mentioning earlier is the different trend of enrichment. So you can see here a ternary diagram illustrating the alkalis on this side, so sodium and potassium, the iron on the top and magnesium. And so often when we have etholeitic magma, usually the tholeites are quite reduced, and so we have a tendency of crystallizing a lot of olivine. So we fractionate olivine in tholeitic magmas, as you know, and because of that we tend to have an indirect enrichment in iron, which will push up the tholeitic series through the process of fractionation, and then it goes down and sort of migrates toward the more alkaline compositions. But the story is different for calc-alkaline magmas. They are more oxidized, and the oxidation favors the precipitation of magnetite. And so these magmas will also lose quite a bit of iron during their history of crystallization and fractionation. As a function of that, you tend to have a linear trend, and you get compositions that are more enriched in calc-alkalic elements, and so you have quite a bit more sodium and potassium in these calc-alkaline series. So this is the example of Guatemala, and samples from Papua as well, which would be sort of more reflective of this calc-alkaline trend. Again, if we look at the petrogenesis of oceanic convergent margins, usually altered oceanic crust will begin to dehydrate at depths of roughly 50 kilometers or less. Then we have further dehydration that occurs with the hydrous phases becoming relatively stable, and this is the example I was mentioning earlier with the Japan case with amphibole. At roughly three gigapascal, we start to have dehydration. This slab is converted to metamorphic rocks, so we form a blue schist, which is a particular type of rock that is a metamorphic rock that quite often is enriched in glaucophane or glaucophane. So that's a mineral that is characteristically bluish in color, and that certainly helps with the definition of blue schist. Remember that glaucophane is an amphibole, and it's a particular amphibole that is associated with subduction zones because it contains sodium, and sodium should trigger you this idea of taking sodium and potassium from seawater. So since we are dehydrating oceanic crust, this will be particularly alkaline and contain potassium and sodium. So we form amphiboles that are unique, they contain sodium. So one example is glaucophane, and the other would be for the pyroxene. So when we go down, we tend to form in the eclogites, we'll find also pyroxene, commonly called omphacites, which are also sodium rich. So quite often, if temperature is relatively below the solidus, we will not cause melting. So it's believed that the water will rise in the mantle wedge, and it's where it reacts with lherzolites, which you should remember from previous lecture, are relatively fertile chunks of mantle, and it's in this context that we formed particular types of amphibole that are still quite enriched in sodium, but they also contain magnesium and calcium, which then are sort of a trigger for the melting and the volatilization. So we have crystal settling and differentiation of basaltic melts taking place at these levels, so below the 100 K, and we form then magma chambers, which will lead to progressive crystallization and the formation of andesites, dacites, and in some cases rhyolites. If we look at the continental arcs now, or active continental margins, so these are the example of the Cascade ranges as well as the Nazca plate, the story is slightly different. You have much more contributions from partial melting of the crust. So we have continental crust that needs to be sort of pierced by major intrusive phases, and because of that you tend to form chains of granitization, so major batholiths will form along the coastal regions of these continents, and also much more pronounced thickening will result from this. In fact, we record the highest thicknesses on the crust together with the continent-continent subduction domains in the Tibetan Plateau, which is the even more elevated example. But still, here we have stratovolcanoes that exceed, in some cases, the 4,000 meters in terms of elevation, which is again a function of the thickening of continental crust, which in some cases reaches the 70 kilometers, which is roughly one order of magnitude thicker than the oceanic crust. So the main difference, remember, it's really that arcs and islands associated with arcs will be dominated by oceanic subduction with the 7 kilometer crust. Instead, if you have presence of continental crust, we get this 70 kilometer thick overlying strata that are sitting on top of the subduction zones. So continental arc magmatism will be influenced by this thick continental crust. And so you could ask, you know, the question of the type of influence you would expect. And it's kind of logical. I mean, if you have a crust that is highly silicic, because it's represented by the accretion of mostly silic crust that results from the granitization processes, then in that sense you will have all sort of interactions of magmas with this very thick chunk of continental crust, which will result in a process called crustal contamination. So during upward migration of the melts will change their composition to reflect the interaction with the crust, which will be more extensive. So this is low density crust, which will retard the ascent and result in more assimilation or differentiation in magma bodies. The low melting point of the crust allows for major partial melting, so big volumes of silic magmas will form, which is a major distinction with the oceanic arcs that we saw are dominated by basaltic and andesitic compositions. So you form what are called crustally derived melts. So the main similarity between continental arcs and island arcs is the subducted oceanic crust. So in both cases, you have a situation where we have oceanic crust going underneath, but here you see this crust is much thinner again, and so the magmas and volatiles don't have a lot of space, and they will mostly melt pre-existing basaltic crust as well. So in a way, you don't get the same level of fractionation that you get in this domain that is much more extensive, much more thicker, and so you can have multiple magmatic chambers at different levels, allowing for extensive rhyolitic magmas as well as extensive situations of explosive activity, and this may be localized in rift systems that form in the back arc part of this major subduction zone. So both cases, of course, will be related to dehydration of the subducting slab, so that process doesn't change. It's really the architectures of the magmatic chambers and the level of fractionation that is the main distinction, which affects, of course, the chemistry and trajectory of magmatic series that form in this context. Some examples are here in South America. You can see the Peru-Chilean trench that is responsible for the consumption of the Nazca plate, which has a major bend in here, and this again could be linked to a tearing of the crust and essentially an increase in magma supply because of that, which forms what is called the central volcanic zone in South America, spanning Peru and a part of Chile. Here we find some of the biggest porphyry deposits in the world, so some people argue that some of the mineralization is really connected with the tearing and change in slope that occur in subducting slabs in this particular context. We also distinguish the northern volcanic zone and the south volcanic zone. These are our southern volcanic zone and northern are usually represented by younger crust, which is also a major difference. So we need to consider the pre-existing assemblage of a continent. Often a continent is represented by islands of plates or plates that are all connected and were accreted together, which could have a completely different history. And so you might find adjacent crust that has a far different age, for example. Here we have Precambrian crust in the central part that is often more enriched in precious metals, for example, and that is really contributing to the complexity as well as the history of volcanism and the style of volcanism that we find in this continent. So in response to the change in the slope of the slab, it's important to remark that usually you get different dipping orientations. So you will get segments of the subducting plate that have a steep pattern, so 25 to 30 degrees, so relatively steep, and other parts that will be more shallow, on the order of 10 to 15 degrees. Commonly, the volcanism tends to be concentrated in those areas that are more steep, and as a consequence of that, we get an irregular pattern in the distribution of volcanoes. And this is really important to understand. So we will get essentially gaps in certain parts of the subducting plates where we do not really record any major volcanism, and other regions instead, which are the steeper ones, that will have a significant volcanism. Another important concept is this idea of having a situation which the thickening take place because of the movement of the subducting plate. So quite often you have an initial phase in which the oceanic plate starts to enter in subduction and you have associated volcanism, but there is no major deformation of the continent. But in this example here, with the migration of the trenches, so it's important to understand that these systems are dynamic, we can get situations in which we compress the continental crust. This compression usually forms an erosion, and so you have thrusting that develops, and in response to that, crustal uplift. We will see in other cases, like the cascade ranges, this process is subsequently followed by extension, and so we can have delamination that occurs, and so we erode away some of these high elevations that derive from this initial compression. So we were talking about the different areas of volcanism in South America that are linked to the Chile-Peru subduction zone. And this is an example of the style of volcanism found in the southern volcanic zone. So we look at a couple of volcanoes. This is in Melipecuo in Chile again, and the volcano is called Lima or Yaima, depending on the language, if you use the Spanish. But yeah, it's quite critical as a volcano and has some historical implications with its explosivity in 1640, for instance, which is roughly 150 years after the discovery of America. So we had major colonization at the time, and some of the wars between Spanish and indigenous people involved also a population called the Mapuches. And they were trying to, of course, protect their land because they were native of South America. And because of their belief in gods related to the volcanoes, when this massive explosion occurred in 1640, the current war, which is the Arauco War, was opposed because of this activity. And so this sort of reminds a historical aspect related with the Lima volcano. This volcano has been active also in recent time, and you see in the background an image of the tephra that have been ejected, so explosive activity as expected. This is one of the South American stratovolcanoes. In this case, the eruptions are mixed, so we have again combinations of tephra and lavas that form. Sometimes, like in this example, of even more recent eruptive phases of another important Chilean volcano, the Chaiten. Some of these are even more silicic, so we form the classic domes and massive obsidian eruptions. So usually the dome will be composed dominantly by rhyolites, and they are highly vitreous. So there is a lot of amorphous silica, so volcanic glass, that compose the dome. So when the explosion occurs, so you get massive amounts of fragments of obsidian dispersed around the crater site, but also they can travel quite a bit. In fact, there are records of fragments of obsidian coming from this volcano recorded at more than 400 kilometers of distance. So quite significant eruptions, and these are quite unique as well. So they are really rare events. In fact, the other most famous one is the Alaskan one of the Nova Rupta, which occurred roughly a century ago, so in 1912. So if we put together, you know, a summary of the volcanic activity that occurs in these three distinct belts, I would say volcanic belts are, you know, chains of volcanoes, and we see that we have three majors again, so one in the northern part, and also one that is more central, and one in the southern zone. So here you have a table that illustrates a variety of factors. So we can look at the crustal thickness. So I was mentioning these have different ages. So we go from Mesocenozoic assemblages, which are on the order of 60 million years. And here we have the Precambrian, that will be on the order of 300 million years, so much older crust in the central part. And here we go back pretty much similar ages. Another aspect that we can consider beside the age is the type of volcanic rocks that are found in the different domains, so basalts and andesites. Are actually quite frequent in the southern part. And so it's relatively different to what you find in the other two regions. The most similar would be the northern part, which again has similar ages and gets dominantly andesitic compositions. But you do see that dominantly the volcanoes will be rhyolitic in the central part, and again this is linked with the thickness as well of this crust, so we have also quite a bit of a difference in terms of thickness on the southern and northern is on the order or less than 40 kilometers, in the central part is in some cases close to 70. Okay, other aspects are with respect to the alkalinity. So, of course, we see a major increase in alkalinity when the crust is particularly thick, and this is an indication that crustal contamination is a key role in alkalinity. So, potentially, we have two major factors that influence alkalinity. One, actually three major factors. One will be the thickness of the crust, because you have magma that interacts with more sialic crust. But at the same time, we have to consider also other factors, such as the availability of fluids, so effectively the amount of hydration that occurs in the subducting slab is important. So hydration of the upper mantle is a function of subduction rates, and also the amount of partial melting. So the more mantle you melt, usually the more primitive will be the compositions, and so because of that it's also important to consider the percentage of partial melting of the mantle specifically. So all these factors will influence the alkalinity, but for sake of simplicity, you can think at the relationship between crustal thickness and alkalinity for the sake of this particular example. Of course, this is influencing also all the isotopes. If you remember, I mentioned the enrichment of magmas that may occur because you have crustal contamination, or again other factors that increase the amount of volatiles, and so these will be affecting significantly both the radiogenic content and also the stable isotope contents of, for example, a oxygen 18. So you get very high ratios or very high delta 18 in this central part. So the volcanic rocks usually will be more evolved and felsic in the central part because of this thicker Precambrian basement, and often that is also accompanied by significant mineralization again. So this has also economic importance. If we look at the magma series, revisiting this concept we explained a few slides ago, so looking at tholeitic versus calc-alkalic magmas, we can see a geographic distribution of the magma series in South America. And so if we take these diagrams and we apply them to the different samples that come off the northern, central and southern volcanic zones. So here we have the northern zone, here the central, and this is the southern volcanic zone. So if you look at plots of silica versus potassium, so that's silica with an increasing percentage and potassium again with an increasing percentage, we can plot the range of compositions for these two oxides for each sample. So these points represent samples of rock that have been analyzed for these two elements. And what we can see is the trend. So we have trends, linear trends of these specimens that indicate samples that are relatively low in potassium and other that are relatively high in potassium, as well as gradual increase in the amount of silica. So we have essentially a linear trend in both cases. And this shift is indicated simply that you have two different types of magmatism, and so two distinct magmatic series, because you are fractionating progressively by increasing the amount of silica. So we observe across the different regions a distinction, and so we see here a situations where we start with the more basaltic compositions and move through a more like tholeitic assemblage, which gets more calc-alkalic progressively, and here instead we see a dominantly calc-alkaline sequence. So here the trends are more tight, so we might still have two groups, but most of them are in this calc-alkaline field, and that's quite distinctive of relatively thick crust as seen for the central volcanic zone. And so you see this classic linear trend in the ternary diagram that would suggest that this trend is more calc-alkaline. Here instead we see the curve that is going up and then down, which is an indication that these magmas were more reduced, so less oxidized, and you drop mostly olivine and not much iron. And so you have a rise in the concentration of iron in response to the initial phases of crystallization. This one is also highly calc-alkaline with a significant amount of potassium. We've got a socionitic again series here, which would represent this more distal samples at the end of the crystallization, maybe. Although, yeah, in this case, alkalinity will be higher, and that's dropping also the amount of silica quite a bit. Because this diagram doesn't really reflect the silica. So in this context, I would say that the cluster we see here is the, so So initial compositions will be mostly calc-alkaline, and then they tend to fractionate and get into more high potassium calc-alkaline series, which would be this box up here. So the grid you see here, it's simply a separation of the toleites down here, these two blocks, and these are the calc-alkaline magmas, and this would be the high potassium calc-alkaline magmas. If we change scenery and we look at the northern Cordillera, so we move to North America, where we have the Juan de Fuca Ridge with the present position of the subduction that is occurring in the Cascade Range area. In that sense, we had a much more complex history that illustrates that subduction zones are quite dynamic over geological time. And in this figure, you have well represented this evolution of subduction. So you start at roughly 75 million years with the position of the subduction being located here. You have a bit of warping of the subduction, but a process called rollback will progressively over time lead to the present position of the subduction zone. So you have a retreating slab which rolls back gradually, and this leads to a variety of events, but mostly a shift of the volcanism basically. So you find essentially volcanism occurring at different times, so quaternary and miocenic volcanism. So this is younger, and it's termed the High Cascades, and the Western Cascade would be slightly older in terms of geological time. And so these processes were quite dramatic, and they are different from the volcanism that we have in the Columbia event. So Columbia basalts will come after, and they are much more recent. You know, if you remember, they are on the order of 16 million years. And so the rollback is also isolating the volcanism that is related to the slab. And so you no longer have volcanism that is slab related, and you started to have the rise of a mantle that is underneath the slab. And because of the anomalous geothermal gradient, you keep this region relatively hot, and you continue with magmatism also after the rollback has been completed. So if we look at the different phases, you can see a sketch here that illustrates the tectonic environment. So we have a phase in which the plate was in this position, and so progressively we have a rollback, so the plate moves back and essentially retreats. This retreat of the oceanic plate that is represented by this yellow arrow is also corresponding to extension. As I was mentioning earlier, you start with compression, so the trenches move in this direction, and then this process in some cases rolls back, and as a result of that you get an increase in the thickness of the mantle wedge, and usually a thinner upper crust will develop because of the lamination. So the extension gets this crust much thinner, and this contributes to extensive magmatism, which actually correspond to this phase of major flowed basalts that we already discussed in earlier lectures. So roughly 17 million years, still Miocenic times, but a much more pronounced event of hotspot relative magmatism. So another type of process that is critical in South America and also in North America and is related to subduction is, as stating, the amount of melting that occurs in the upper crust. So you do have the process of crustal contamination is really involving quite a bit of sialic rocks that get melted that are part of the crust. So melting does not occur exclusively in the mantle or in the mantle wedge. It does occur also in the crust, and this is a process called anataxis. So crustal anataxis will lead to the formation of major intrusion phases that have more felsic compositions, so they are quite enriched in quartz, and often they are associated with tonalitic magmas and granodiorites. Here you have images of the distribution of these large igneous bodies that result from the melting of the crust, and they are quite often related to the shallowest part of the subducting slab, because they get uplifted again with the similar process as mentioned earlier. So depending on the dynamic of the subducting plate, you get locations where you develop more extensive exposures of these granitic bodies. And these are commonly called batholiths. So you have the coast batholith here, the peninsular ranges batholith, and the Idaho batholith as examples for North America. In this other part of South America, instead, you get the coastal batholith of Peru, for example, or the northern Chilean one, or the Patagonian batholiths, which are really fantastic. We have incredible mountain ranges with exposed granitic bodies, which are very famous, especially for climbing activities. So it's important to realize that we have quite a bit of igneous rocks that crystallize at depth in these ranges, and they will form this massive amount of granitization, okay, which is in contrast to the volcanism that we observed. So quite often the volcano get completely eroded and you get exposure of these granitic belts. Some of the granitization is fairly complex, I would say. So you have example here of calderas and associated plutonism in Peru, so in the Jaura complex. So we have different phases in this image. It's very complicated, but you can count with the numbers the different phases. For example, for this single granitic body, we do start essentially with the formation of the San Germano granite, and we have then this Puskau granite that is represented by four distinct phases. So how do you form the different phases? It's essentially a process of stopping. So you start forming one phase, and then you have that rock tend to drop, and subsequently it opens up more space on the top part, and it gets infilled by magma. So in this sense, we had the first event was this one. We had the major drop of this Warikanga tonalite, and after that you get infiltration of this phase one of this San Geronimo granite. Then you have a volcanic phase together with that, and then you start with the second phase. So you have drop again and get a second phase that infiltrates them and subsequently the others. So hopefully it makes sense. It's fairly complex, but yeah, you can understand that you have that instabilities usually related with caldera activity will lead to the development of blocks of granitic rocks that drop because of gravity. And this is usually related to the retreat of the magmatic chamber. So there is a cyclicity, and this is manifested with these different levels of intrusions. In terms of compositions, these rocks tend to be dominantly tonalitic to granodioritic in composition, and this is expected because we are in a subduction-related environment, so there is a lot of influence derived from the mantle wedge. So a lot of magma ponding, as we will see, contributes to relatively mafic compositions rather than highly felsic and alkalic. And this example is represented here. So you have a phase in which the subduction is proceeding, and it's causing dehydration, and the melting occurs in the mantle, of course, and we tend to accumulate significant amounts of magma at the base of the continental crust. So this is creating a geothermal anomaly, and so you have enriched mantle because of the dehydration and continuous melting taking place, which also digests a significant amount of continental crust. This process will lead to granitization and deformation of tonalitic plutons, which you can see in here. So I didn't really follow the order, but firstly you will form these gabbroic plutons, which then gets lumped together and they form the underplating, so the brown part, and then you get secondary magmatic chambers forming that are composed by melt that is mixed with the crust, and so it gets more tonalitic in composition. Remember the distinction between a gabbro and a tonalite, it's really the amount of silica. So that is easily explained by the incorporation of sialic crust, which is highly silicic. So magma underplating is a particular important process. Often you have that this is also linked to tectonics. So we have different phases. We start with extensional tectonics, in which we can sort of favor the development of, for example, calderas and volcanism. And instead, during compression, we have a phase in which we have uplifting, and we tend to erode away the volcanoes and rather expose the tonalitic complexes as well as the caldera volcanic infill, which is commonly represented by volcanic clastic and pillows. If we look at the process of melting that occurs in continental crust, which is the main factor that contributes to the production of granitic rocks, we can use these phase diagrams. So petrogenetic diagrams of this type illustrate with these different curves transitions in terms of mostly mineralogy or the condition of saturation in terms of amount of fluids in the magma. So of course here we are increasing temperature and increasing pressure as well. So we are going at depth following different geothermal gradients. So if you have relatively anomalous geothermal gradients, which would be explained by the proximity to a mantle wedge, what we observe is a progressive change in the mineralogy, and we get essentially saturation of water in magmas and a tendency of extracting waters from minerals. So this corresponds usually to a transition. We go from muscovite-rich assemblages into more potassium feldspar assemblages and other alumosilicates, plus liquid, and often we have situations in which you have production essentially of water of also biotite. So when you hit a certain temperature, you tend to convert also biotite again into garnet and k-feldspar. So a situation in which you lose water from the biotite and it becomes available as volatiles. This can be also represented in here with the amount of melt. Of course, if you have more water available, it's easier to melt rocks. So this transition, mineralogical transition, often corresponds to jumps in the percentage of melt in response to the breakdown of muscovite and biotite dominantly, and then in relationship to the melting of anhydrous phases with the gradual sort of increase of melt percentages in this last example. So not as sharp as seen for these other two cases. So this essentially has two ranges, so at 1680 we get a jump, and at 760 as well with the consumption and breakdown of biotite. So in summary, to sort of summarize all the processes that we discussed, you have to remember five major processes. We have dehydration, partial melting, which can occur both in the mantle. So we commonly partial melting, we refer to mantle, and then you have fractionation, which we already seen extensively. Remember the Bowen sequence. Underplating, which is when the magma accumulates really at the bottom of the crust for some time because of the density. So we equilibrate same density, so magma ponding occurs. And then anataxis will be equivalent to partial melting, but it's a contest that is different. It's within crust, so we are melting only continental crust. When we do partial melting of continental crust, we mention that as anataxis for sake of distinguishing between melting of crust versus melting that is more related to the melting that occurs in the mantle wedge. Some examples here of dating, often granitic rocks that are produced of these melting or anataxis of the crust, often contain minerals, accessory minerals such as zircon. Zircon is quite useful. It can be used to date the crystallization of the granite, basically, and many times zircon will record different overgrowths, which can be igneous or metamorphic, and they offer an insight on the history and evolution of magmas. So this is more of a curiosity, but certainly it's important to realize that we can date also granitic rocks as we do for the volcanic rocks that are the basalts, when we look at dating them together with understanding their paleomagnetic significance. So remember them, they have quite a bit of magnetite. So dating certainly possible also for granitic assemblages. This is useful to recover, you know, the history, so you can plot age versus distance from a coastline, for example. And people have been arguing and sort of trying to understand the relationship between the age of these volcanic events and major batholitic provinces, and also this subduction history again. So very complicated. So for example, we see that the coastal batholiths tend to be older, and they are, however, sort of closer in terms of distance from the coast if compared to the eastern stocks and the Cordillera Blanca. So some of these aspects are quite challenging. You would expect actually the opposite with the progression of the slab, but probably this is linked to other things, for example, the shallowing of the deep of the subduction zone sometimes can lead to these unique patterns. Same examples here for an older plutonic arc, so the peninsula range in batholith, and also the younger plutonic arc here. So they look like they are more sort of further away from the coast when they are younger. In terms of types of tectonic settings where the granitization process or the development of batholiths is mostly important, certainly the one we just reviewed, so conditions in continental arcs are the one that leads to the thicker granitization, as well as these other that we are going to review in this final part of this lecture, which is the term the continental collision. So these are the two regions, not that there aren't other regions where we form granites, but these will be less pronounced. So the magmatism that is granitic, it can occur also in transitional zones, which would be more distal from the subduction, so back arc domains, for example, and also in a post-orogenic phase when you have that the subduction rolls back. In that sense, you get also other granitization, but is more negligible. So you get thinner crust, less volumes of melt, and so less significant processes for the development of batholitic provinces. If we take these examples, so the continental collision, we do see a major difference with what we've seen so far, which is the fact we increase even more the involvement of continental crust, because we are effectively subducting continental crust under other continental crust, and this is the example of Tibet. So subduction occurs through undertrusting, usually, of the continental slab. And so you have a situation that causes quite commonly anomalous geothermal gradients. And these anomalies, it's quite interesting to see these curves that intersect not only the lithospheric mantle, so they also influence significantly the crust. And because of that, and this is related to the thickness, you can see goes up to 70 here or even more. And so you get that in reality, the majority of the melting, the partial melting, will be focused really in crustal rocks rather than mantle rocks. So here you have an image of the Himalayas. So we see the Indian plate that is going in subduction, and it's highly deformed. So you have slivers of Indian plate that essentially go into this main central thrust that connects with the Eurasian plate. So all these chunk of rocks are going in subduction, and then you have other things here entrained. So for example, ophiolitic sequences. If you remember, I've shown you images of serpentinites and sheeted dike complexes on the top of the Tibetan plateau. Those would be these ophiolitic sequences. But yeah, the cool thing is that dehydration occurs really in the Indian plate, so we have quite a bit of dehydration that occurs within the crust, and so you get also anataxis, so partial melting of crust that is exclusively represented by magmas that are produced by crust, so they will be highly silicic because of that. So you get these laccogranites forming, so rocks that are extremely leucocratic, indicating again a lot of fractionation, so high level of fractionation. These orogenies are very complicated. You get usually a process called collapse. Post-orogenic collapse is quite common. So you have here a schematic of this process called delamination. So of course you have a phase of compression here when we get this magmatism and development of a variety of granitoids, and then progressively the compression will lead to a thickening of the crust, so significant thickening, so thick that at some stage you get what is called an inversion of the orogen. So inversion will lead to extension of the crust. Again, we talk about rollback, but in some cases you have really fragmentation of the slabs. So the slabs get fragmented, and because of that you essentially literally lose chunks of the lower crust, and in response to that you get a thinner crust and instability. So there is no longer a root that can sustain the orogen, and so you get even further extension. And so in the top part you get this major delamination with thinning of the granitic crust, which end up being a post-orogenic phase with extension and low volume of granitoids forming. So in conclusion, we can say that most granitoids of significant volume will occur in areas where the continental crust has been thickened by an orogeny. So orogenies are the key ones, and in fact all those South American and North American batholith complexes are found actually in correspondence of these orogenies. Because the crust is solid, some thermal disturbance will be required to form the granitic complexes. So that's obvious. So you need to have, either a subduction zone that is oceanic or continental to allow enough thickening to have an anomalous geotherm forming. Which leads to again partial melting or anataxis of the crust. And most workers are of the opinion that the majority of these granitoids are derived by crustal anataxis, so it confirms pretty much what I was mentioning. So in essence you need to have anomalous geothermal gradients that interest the lower crust, so that you can allow for major anataxis, which is this case of the Himalayas, or alternatively you will need to have magma ponding, so development of major gabbroic bodies at the interface between the mantle and the lower crust to allow subsequent digestion and partial melting or anataxis of sialic crust. That's the second process that will lead you to major crustal anataxis and production in this particular case of more tonalitic compositions. So this concludes this ninth lecture, and it's also concluding the majority of the revision of tectonic environments and associated magmatism and plutonic rocks. We are left only with a special lecture that will still consider intrusive rocks and major intrusive bodies, but it will be rather focused on layered intrusions. So these are more distinctive and unique types of magmatism on Earth. So they need a dedicated lecture, which will be lecture 10.